Hello friends, welcome to CEC Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in this session, we are going to talk further in our series on 20th century world literature. Dear friends, for the discussion, we have with us in our studios Professor Anand Prakash. And dear friends, firstly, we would like to tell you all, we are going to talk on Egyptian writer Naguib Mahfouz. And for the discussion, as I already told, we have with us in our studios Professor Anand Prakash, a retired professor of English from Delhi University. Friends, if you wish to ask questions from Professor Anand Prakash on today's topic, then do call us through our toll-free number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. I repeat, our number is 1-800-110-430. All dear friends are requested to call in the last 10 minutes of the lecture, as well as friends, you are kindly requested to ask questions relevant to the topic only. And if you have any doubts in mind regarding the topic, then don't worry at all, because we are going to give you in-depth knowledge on today's topic. As I already told, we are going to talk on Egyptian writer Naguib Mahfouz, and Professor Anand Prakash is already to give you the deep insight. Hello sir, welcome to the lecture.
Thank you Geetika, and welcome viewers. Today's topic, as has been announced, is the Egyptian writer Naguib Mahfouz, arguably one of the best fiction writers in the 20th century world literature. This person was living in tumultuous times. There were lots of ups and downs going on in his political and cultural environment in Egypt. And he lived through the whole 20th century. He was born in 1911 and he died in 2006, so good 95 years. And through this period, he also evolved a style that finally suited his writerly requirements. The 20th century, one of the most happening century in human history, as all of us know. There have been two world wars. There have been movements against regimes in almost all parts of the world, all countries. And the writers have lived through these changes, these happening segments of time, with great difficulty and alertness. Why I say this is because writers always become, in the final analysis, the voice of the age. And for people at a particular time, any country suffer, are under pressure, they face problems, they have difficult questions to face, then those questions are largely articulated in a very complex sense by the writer. In fact, all people who are active in the field of knowledge, in the field of politics, culture, society, have this task cut for them to voice the ups and downs, the difficulties of the people. But so far as the writers are concerned, they have a very different kind of a role to play. They have no authority except, their own judgment. Circumstances are never in agreement with them. I'll dilate on this topic later on. But then Naguib Mahfouz went through all these things, in his life, and he very well navigated in his career regarding these problems that I have in mind. He's a writer in Arabic, born in Cairo, Egypt, in the early part of the 20th century. He wrote in the span of his life 30 novels and a large number of other things also, non-fiction works. In 1988, his talent was recognized the world over when he got the Nobel Prize for Literature, and then he became in the intellectual circle of the world, a name to reckon with. People, read his works with respect, with a kind of awe also, because the way he would present things would not be the easy way. And at the same time, he had such a way with language, he had such an ease with representation of difficult issues, that even the ordinary person on the street would understand what he was saying. He would not say directly, his mode was fiction, so he would use his imagination, he would use fantasy, He would imagine, you know, people were talking to one another. He would mimic their voice. He would present their, you know, embarrassments, their sense of instability, all those things through language. So his weapon was language, and his means of, you know, using that weapon was in the domain of literature. So that kind of a person. He read philosophy at Cairo University in 1930, when he was 19 years. So his orientation, his mental orientation is philosophy. Philosophy, which means an abstraction. You have some kind of a fact in mind, and then you talk about that fact in language, and then you use concepts. And later on, your job is to agree with the concepts that you have used earlier. So in fact, a kind of system starts building up in the mind of the philosopher. The philosopher is guided by what he or she said yesterday, what he or she might be saying tomorrow. So this kind of consistency is required for the philosophical discipline, and rightly or wrongly, this person started his career in the intellectual field as a philosopher, as a student of philosophy. And this philosophy would have given him a kind of dimension to literature, a kind of depth to literature, which other people who don't read philosophy might lack. So he read philosophy at Cairo University in 1930. He also wrote nonfiction, most penned during the 1930s. Why 1930s? You may wonder. What is so specific about 1930s in Egypt and also in the world? And let me tell you that the 1930s is a very, change-oriented period for the whole world. In India, for instance, 1930s is a decisive phase. This is the phase, you know, that starts with Bhagat Singh's martyrdom. This starts with the dissensions in Congress, as far as India is concerned. In Europe, in England, 1930s starts with hanging between the First World War and the Second World War, which is yet to come. But then the clouds are there, the war atmosphere is building up, and the entire Western world is shaken up with the very idea, with the apprehension of the war that might happen any time. In 1930s, our author, Naga Mehfooz, would be preparing to express himself in a serious manner through philosophy, through comment, through fiction, and therefore he would be moving around all these areas one after another uncertainly. And in this period, it was necessary for Naga Mehfooz to clarify his position unto himself as a writer as to what he thought about things. And therefore, what he did was he would take pen in hand, he would look around, and he would express himself directly, not through imagining characters, not through imagining situations, not using his fantasy, but talking directly to himself and to his readers. So he wrote those non-fiction works, those essays, in 1930, when he was hardly 20 years or so. And in the 20s, if somebody writes, then one is not clear about what I have to say, which means that as you write as a person of 20 years, 25 years, 30 years, then most of the time you are exploring. You are getting clear to yourself. You are anyway engaging with the issues directly, and you are not sure as to what you have to say. So is that good or bad? Should we read such a writing or not? This is a question that I ask myself, and you can also ask this question from yourself. So far as I am concerned, I think this kind of a writing, which is the formative period, which brings in the formative period of the writer, this is very helpful in understanding the core of that person's writing when it will emerge later, because you are seeing the mind of the writer in its formation, how the person is, you know, taking influences from his surroundings, how he is interpreting them, how he is making mistakes, how in the course of making the mistakes he is becoming aware of the difficulties, and then finally correcting his path. So this process of growing up as a thinker and as a writer is something very fascinating to watch. And when we read his essays of this time, then we have clues to what he said later in his fictional works. In his literary essays, he discusses a wide range of authors. And you can discuss authors only if you have read them. Therefore, he would be reading day and night all these authors of the world, not merely of Egypt, of the world. And he will take the best points from all these authors that will appeal to him to write on his own. So he discusses a wide range of authors from Anton Chekhov to his own contemporaries like Taha Hussein. So he reads his contemporaries, he also reads the Russian authors, particularly Anton Chekhov, and as all of us know, Anton Chekhov of Russia, who was writing in the late 19th century and early 20th century, was a short story writer, a writer of fiction, and a person who had influence wielded all over the world. He also ventured into, in his non-fiction writing, a host of important contemporary issues. What are they? They could be politics, they could be culture, they could be the ways people thought and responded to their problems, including science and modernity. That is important. If somebody, you know, starts understanding science at the age of 30, then, you know, one's very view of things changes. Science, you know, is always based on study of the facts, not any kind of source of knowledge coming from anywhere else. So one doesn't go beyond the reality, one doesn't go beyond society, one doesn't go beyond, you know, one's surroundings. So one takes the facts as they are in front of oneself, examines them, those facts, and then, you know, studies their nature. So science, this, that gives that kind of a discipline to a person and makes him virtually, you know, a person who is interested in understanding reality and modernity. Now, saying that one is modern is very easy. All of us can say we are modern, but being a modern is very difficult and also a risky venture, because, you know, in society there are a large number of people who don't believe in modernity. They believe in tradition, they believe in all kinds of systems that work in life, and those systems may have played their role in history, in society, in the previous decades and centuries. But if you revive them, if you keep them intact, in fact, in your life, then, you know, they become an obstacle. So becoming a modern person is a challenge, and this person, he read science and he became a modernist, modernist in the good sense of the word, that he would be a modern mind, he would not be a traditional dogmatic mind. So science and modernity, the growing movement for women's rights in the Arab world, very hot area. Talking about women's interests once again is calling for all kinds of punishment, all kinds of repression and suppression. And if women's issues are taken by Nagihima Fools in the you know, beginning of his career, and he is getting sympathetic towards them, and he sees them as human beings equal to others, who have a role to play, not merely around the home and the hearth, but also in the outside world. If he takes such a position, if he considers women as equal, who are equal citizens in the sense that they understand things as well as men do, and that they have to be given a social right to also participate in the larger action, then of course this person would invite criticism from his fellows, from his contemporaries, but then this is an act of courage, and this itself will, you know, take him forward in understanding the reality of his time. So all these things, and then growing movement for women's rights in the Arab world, emerging ideologies like socialism. Now this is a new ideology. This ideology had its roots in the 19th century, but it was very young in the early part of the 20th century. The socialist ideology would be as young as 60 or 70 years. And if in those years this became so strong that it started posing a threat to the existing systems all over the world, then a writer would be one of the first people to find out why it is so important, why it is so powerful, why it is so inspiring, why does it disturb people so much. So all these questions the writer would ask from oneself and will find answers. So this person is in fact taking all the challenging aspects of modern life from his surroundings, and he's working them out in his own mind. And when he has worked them out, when he has put them in place, when he has put them in a sequence, when he has put them in the hierarchy of preferences, this is more important, this is less important, and when he is guided by these values and these ideas, then of course he will understand the surroundings much better than others who do not do this. So all of which outline the growing challenges to traditional modes of living that he saw all around him. So traditional modes of living and the modern ways of living. All these modes, you know, have to be contended with, have to be analyzed, And then if you find that they are worth adopting, then he would also adopt them. Now, before I go into the background of this author in Egypt, let me tell you that this is the kind of response he received, in fact I would say earned, from the fellow intellectuals of the world. There is a man called Edward Said, he's a household name these days in the intellectual circles. This person, you know, is a Palestinian, he's a Christian, and he died, you know, a few decades ago. He was the main critical theorist in the 20th century. This is what Edward Said says about him. He says, as a citizen, Nagi Mahfouz sees civility and the continuity of transnational abiding Egyptian personality. It's a difficult thing to say, and he is saying this difficult thing in a very sophisticated manner. First is civility. This person believes in peace. This person believes in good manners. This person believes in arguing so that the other person understands. This person believes in learning from the argument of the other. This is called civil. You know, a civilized person, a civil person, a person who is cordial, a person who is sweet, if there is a person who is open to reason. So he has that kind of civility in him. So it would be a pleasure, you know, meeting such a person in life, that you go, you ask questions, you make queries, and this person sweetly is answering, keeping in mind your sensitivities also. So that is the kind of civility that Nagi Mahfouz represented so far as Edward Said is concerned. But then the second point he is making, now try to grasp that in its essence. What he says is that he believes in a kind of continuity of transnational abiding Egyptian personality. What is that? How can Egyptian personality be transnational? Egyptian personality generally is an Egyptian personality grounded in the reality of Egypt. Like in India, if I am an Indian, then I should be grounded in my own country and I should not bother about other people elsewhere in the world. But this person is transnational. He goes beyond the nationalism and nationality of Egypt. He wants to understand the world. In fact, this takes us very close to the very spirit of the series of lectures that we are organizing. We are talking about world literature. So this person is from Egypt, he writes in Arabic, but he writes for the whole world. He writes for the American, he writes for the Russian, he writes for the Canadian, he writes for Indian. So all these things, you know, are there in his mind as humanity. So such a person is given this epithet by Edward Said, that he is transnational in his interests, abiding, you know, he will remain, he will not easily die out. Even though physically he is not there, but Nagi Mahfouz would be read and appreciated in the 21st century, in the 22nd century also, and his contemporaries, those who didn't agree with him, they also would like to read him and learn from him. So this is called abiding. Abiding means it lasts, it remains. So these are the compliments that Nagi Mahfouz earns from Edward Said. And he says he's perhaps the surviving the, and he survived the, says Edward Said, he survived the debilitating process of conflict. This is the crux. It's not easy to live in the 20th century. The 20th century for all sensitive people is very debilitating, very weakening, destroying, destructive. It's very, very difficult to live on in the 20th century, says Edward Said. And this person not only lived on, he survived it. And he kept his, you know, sanity, he kept his approach, he kept his attitude intact while living through those troubled times. And he's more than anyone else, says Edward Said, I have read, he says, has so powerfully depicted. He has depicted this process of surviving in this world as a civil person, as a person who believes not in Egyptian nationalism, but in the humanism of the whole world. So these are the comments of Edward Said on Nagi Mahfouz, and I think our curiosity is sufficiently aroused to understand now as to what kind of writing he did and under what pressures. So I now go on to the next point, and I talk a few things about contemporary Egypt. Contemporary Egypt, the Egypt that this man saw, the Egypt of the 1920s and 30s, when he was a young boy in the 1920s, he was a young man in the 1930s, and later on he became adult. And he would look at things, you know, from a very mature angle through the century. And when he does that, then Egypt is changing. Now, this concept of changing of the society also should be kept in mind as a vital factor of discussion. Egypt is changing in the 20th century. How is it changing? Let us go into the history of Egypt. Egypt initially was a kind of a place where people came for getting the slaves, the slave owners. And you know, most of the Egyptian people till the early medieval time would be the slaves. They would be Mamluks. They were called Mamluks, and they could not organize themselves properly. They didn't have a language. They could not get together as slaves, and therefore they were attacked by the Ottoman Empire, the Turkish Empire. And when the Turkish Empire came, then you know, some kind of sense of organization, sense of arrangement, sense of sequence that started occurring. So this Ottoman Empire remained in Egypt from let us say the 16th century onwards till the 19th century. And in the 19th century, then people thought, you know, that these were the imperialists who had come from another country having their own language, and they should be resisted. So somebody called Muhammad Ali in the 1880s, in the 19th century, towards the end of the 19th century, he resisted the Ottoman Empire and he established an empire of one's own. Muhammad Ali then became a kind of a king in the 19th century. And he then would start managing the affairs of Egypt in his own manner. Now, what are king's own manners? That the all power of the country will remain in his hands and his supporters, that the entire wealth of the country will be under his control, and that all the policies that the society needs or according to him requires, those policies will be framed by him. So let us call this word monarchy. So Egyptian people get a kind of monarchy in the latter part of the 19th century. And then you know, then there is a fight of interests between this monarch and you know, people from outside. Egypt is very strategically placed in the world. If you see Egypt, on one side is Africa, on the other side is Arabia, on the third side is the Eastern world. And there is no sea around that time. So there is a Suez Canal that opens into the sea from one side and into the other, and that is a very important route. And the Britishers would like to use this route. All others from Europe would like to use this route. So the strategic positioning of the Egyptian part of the world, this positioning makes it very important. And you know, then Britishers will put pressure on Muhammad Ali, the person who was the monarch. And then you know, there's discontent in the country, and then you know, Britishers become the they make this country a kind of protectorate. They keep it under their hold, and they realize, you know, that people have to be now managed differently. So you have a clash of cultures. There's a culture of monarchy happening in Egypt. And there is another culture that is putting pressure from outside, and that is the British culture. So this clash would occur in the first part of the 20th century, and gradually this monarch will get resistance. And then this is actually a part of modernization. And when you know this clash occurs, then modernization is there, and perhaps this thing would have made the young Nag Mahfouz a modernist and one who believed in science at that point of time. So I believe that this is the background against which this writer should be seen. And politically and culturally, Egypt is changing color, is becoming different from what it was, and that's a good time for writers to be born in, so that they can absorb these influences and put them into their writing as an integrated, you know, aspect. Thank you.
With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so much for giving us this session. Friends, you are requested to be with us as we are back after a short break, and we are going to discuss more. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome back to this session. Friends, as you know that today we are talking on Egyptian writer Naguib Mahfouz, and for the discussion we have with us in our studios Professor Anand Prakash. Professor Anand Prakash is a prolific professor and we are always enlightened by him. Friends, if you wish to be enlightened more and more, then you have a privilege to ask questions. You have a privilege to become part of this live session. You can ask questions from Professor Anand Prakash on today's topic, that is on Egyptian writer Naguib Mahfouz. Friends, for contacting us, you need to note down our toll-free number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. I repeat, our number is 1-800-110-430. We are waiting for your calls, and till then, I would request Professor Anand Prakash to continue further so that all the students could get more and more of knowledge on the topic.
Thanks, Geetika, and welcome again, viewers. And I had given a brief view of how, you know, Egypt emerged from earlier the slave reality to the Ottoman Empire, where it was kind of a colony till the 19th century, and from there, you know, other interests clashed, and then Egypt came into its own by having its own independent monarchy in the first part of the 20th century. We go from here. I'll just take 2 or 3 minutes to bring the time, particularly with respect to the writing of this author. And I say that Egypt becomes a vibrant economy, a vibrant culture, a vibrant society in the middle of the 20th century, when, you know, it also puts an end to the Egyptian monarchy. Monarchy had its restrictions. Monarchy always kept the hierarchy intact. People didn't have any rights. All the rights were, you know, vested in the king and the court. And in 1952, a kind of rebellion happens. That rebellion is led by certain army officers, and the leader, Nasser, Colonel Nasser, he takes over. He's the first president of the new republic. And imagine, from monarchy to republicanism. What is republicanism? Republicanism is a kind of democracy in which all human beings are equal and that they have equal rights, and that nobody is considered on the basis of privilege superior to others, you know, who are underprivileged. So the law changes, elections happen, policies are made keeping in mind the requirements and needs of society, and it's a free, independent, open society. And that's what Egypt becomes in 1952. Now imagine that this is exactly the time when India also becomes free from the British colonial rule. 1952, India already has earned independence in 1947, 5 years, and then Egypt also becomes a kind of republic. And in some respects, I believe Egypt is slightly closer to Russia than India was. It was a kind of a Russian ally at that time, though not officially, but then there were certain understandings with Russia in the mind of Nasser, and that took the country forward. So this is one important thing that happens. And Nasser is a popular leader, and he can win elections on his own, and he rules still as president of the state. He rules till his death in 1970. Then, you know, another army officer takes over as the president again. His name is Anwar Sadat, and he will remain in office till 1981, when he will be assassinated. He will be killed. Now, this is something violent to happen in Egypt, that a person came and shot him dead. Why did it happen? Society has, in fact, violence at its core in most of the cases. And this violence resides not in the personal ambition of this or that person. That, in fact, appears to be the case. Actually, violence is built into the system. So there must have been contending groups in Egypt, and one group, you know, knew that power could not be snatched unless the leader was killed, and therefore they must have organized, you know, this kind of a killing over time, and the organizers of the killers would have got the support from, blessings from, maybe the sources outside the world. I told you, I gave a clue about this in the beginning itself of this process, that Egypt had become some kind of an ally of USSR at that time, and that would hurt the interests of the rest of the world, the American imperialist part, and maybe people were active there who had sympathies with the Western capitalist world, and they always wanted to create trouble for Anwar Sadat and his friends. And when the opportunity came, then he was assassinated. After that assassination in 1981, Hosni Mubarak takes over. Hosni Mubarak also was a very popular leader, like Nasser and so Anwar Sadat, and he ruled for another 10 or 12 years, and the country was stable. But what was happening behind the scene was different. Nobody could match, you know, the dynamism and the brilliance of Nasser, and the same policies in a slightly diluted form was also pursued by his successor. And Hosni Mubarak too was a Democrat, but in the meantime a problem was occurring slowly and gradually in the body politic of the country, and that was that people were somehow organizing themselves, mobilizing themselves against the socialist principles of equality. And what they wanted was that, you know, the property, the business, the production houses, they should be privatized. And privatization occurred in Hosni Mubarak's time, even though as a person, as a president, he would like to stop such a process to the extent possible. So that remained. Now, why I'm saying all this? Because these different leaders in Egypt, starting from 1952 up to the 2011, when Hosni Mubarak is also taken away from power, and when, you know, a rightist regime, a regime, you know, who is supported by the Islamists, that takes over. So why I'm saying this is that these are the times which are creating issues for the people to discuss. And this person is lucky, Naguib Mahfouz is lucky that he's living in such times, you know, when ideas are evolving, when our society is changing, when policies are being discussed, you know, among the people, when people write about them, and when in discussion there is a kind of clash also. So in that kind of a lively atmosphere, this person has operated as a literary figure, and for this reason, you know, he got a lot of material, got a lot of, you know, stuff to think about and to represent in his writing, and that in fact made him a great writer. So against this background, this person is going to flourish. This is what I say. In 1952, he started writing in 1930s onwards, and he was writing from one angle and from slightly different angle later. But then he got steeped into the realistic questions of the 1960s and 70s and 80s. So all these days he was active, actively learning from the reality as it was unfolding itself before him in the country called Egypt. So two general things happened in this period. It starts as a kind of a socialist country, not exactly socialist country in the sense that there is a political party called Socialist Party or Communist Party, not that way. But the principles of socialism, of equality and democracy, they are being observed by the three presidents, you know, who gave wonderful time to Egypt, and it was called the Golden Period. And then towards the end, when crisis occurred, and crisis has different faces, it might occur from within the country, it might occur from pressures that come from outside. So whatever, we are not going into that as scholars of literature, but I would say that when the country was moving towards crisis of the new kind, it is then, you know, that Hosni Mubarak also became a great figure for this writer, because he was trying to keep democracy intact. So what you see in Naguib Mahfouz is his love for democracy. And for this reason, I will just take a few quotes from him, and these quotes will tell us as to what exactly, you know, he said regarding these issues. He, before I give his quotations to you, let me tell you that this person is a writer of fiction. He writes short stories, he writes novels, he writes different kinds of novels. He starts his career as a novelist, you know, who writes about history. Generally, he is a contemporary writer. He writes about the problems of the day, but he starts his career as a writer of Egyptian history. So imagine the kind of dilemma that he faced. He would not write about dogma. He will not write about tradition. He will not write about recent history, but he will write about a history that made this country so tough in terms of ideology and in terms of culture. So he goes back to the ancient period and he draws his inspiration from that period when people were living differently in Egypt. So he writes a trilogy, writes three novels in a series, and those novels actually tell us the way this country came into being as a political and as a cultural entity. And these novels made him famous, and after that he got his Nobel Prize. But then, once he had told this history of the making of Egypt in the minds of the people over a long period of time, over a period of let's say 10 centuries or even more, this period equipped him, this writing equipped him to then take on to the individual challenges of the country at the time. So then he shifted his interest from that kind of ancient history to the present moment. And then he wrote about issues and problems regarding poverty, regarding inequality, regarding women's interests, regarding the clash between men and women, women and women, men and men. And you know, he made things very complex. And he would not take sides there as a great writer, and he became a realistic writer. We have other lectures, you know, in the series where we discuss realism. But here is an example of realistic writing, writing of a kind that engages with the problems of the day. And his novels, his short stories, particularly his novels of this period, they talk about the issues that emerge from time to time in the culture and the society of the time. The time in which he writes is called the Golden Age of Liberal Thought. This is very important. Thought is liberal. It's not conservative. It's not also, you know, very dictatorial. Nobody tells you what to believe in. What they say is, okay, one person believes in this, the other person believes in the opposite. Let the two remain. Let the two keep discussing. This is called liberal thought. Liberal thought does not give its preference so very clearly that one thing is right and the other thing is wrong. Liberal thought is that where people can, with different ideas, can coexist with each other. And since that period is inspiring writers to write, therefore, this person must have flowered and flourished in the epoch in which he wrote. He was wholeheartedly immersed in modern thought and the European model as the gateway to modernity. He wrote in the European tradition. He didn't write in the Egyptian tradition. He learned from Egypt the wisdom of humanity, but then that wisdom was tempered by his knowledge of the Western world. There's no doubt that there is a kind of renaissance in England and in Europe, and that renaissance gave a new perspective to the human beings, and that perspective was missing in the rest of the world. So this person, as a wakeful person, as an alert person, as an intelligent person, will take the open-mindedness of renaissance from Europe, and he will internalize it, and then he will mold it in such a manner that this became useful for the Egyptian writing. So some critics, in fact, have pointed out as the weakness of this person, that this person doesn't engage himself with the thought of the country to which he belongs. But then his answer would be that he knows what the country is. The country was formed in the ancient time. There it had wisdom. Later on, it went off the track. And if it went off the track, then there's no point, you know, preserving those particular ideas, which are divisive ideas. So then, you know, he would take inspiration from the Western thought, and he would use that model in order to enlighten the audience about the reality of the present time. Several of his early short stories, and more importantly, his first three full-length novels were historical, as I told you, set in ancient Egypt in a series of grand narratives. And he is compared then with Walter Scott, the English writer who came from Scotland and who wrote historical novels. So this person also started writing historical novels, keeping Walter Scott as his model. But then he abandons this. After the first three instances in favor of realism, which I have already talked about, he becomes a realistic writer and he starts depicting the contemporary social scene, the household, the market, the street, the college, the scholars, all these things, you know, poverty, unemployment, these things, you know, he starts taking into consideration in order to. And later on, when he thought, you know, that the world was getting too much into, subjective interests, Then, you know, he also toyed with the idea of Sufism, transcendentalism. But then he found that Sufism was in fact taking one away from society, and therefore he started criticizing that. So that's the kind of career he has, that he starts as a writer of history, a historical play, a historical novels. From there he shifts to the contemporary fiction. Then he also toys with the idea of Sufism and finds that of not enough interest. What does this mean? This means that the writer is dynamic in his understanding. He doesn't get stuck to one theme. He doesn't get stuck to one idea. He doesn't get stuck to one time. He keeps on growing and evolving according to the demands of the period. So he meets the period in literature halfway. This part is mine, he says. This part is my imagination. These are my ideals, but these I'll keep them only up to a point. Beyond that, I would like to understand your point. Your means the society's point, other people's point. And when literature meets this kind of a writer, makes available to this kind of a writer a terrain in which on the one side is society and on the other side is the writer, then of course the writing that he wrote, that quality of writing, gets expressed. So this is the kind of writing he has, in which, you know, there are characters, in which there are comments, in which there are stances, in which there are opinions, and no opinion is final. No character is complete. And, he tells the stories very well, and in those stories, you know, he problematizes rather than offering solutions. He doesn't offer solutions in his writing. He problematizes. For instance, he explains a position from different angles and then leaves for the reader to find out which of the three or four angles that are there in the representation, which are the good ones to adopt. So that kind of a liberal writer this becomes, even though his inclination is towards scientific thinking, to secularism, to social realism, to equality, to respect to women, all these things he has. But then he doesn't impose his views on his reader. And this will become clear, when I give some quotations from him. These quotations occur sometimes in his books, sometimes directly in his interviews, because he is widely interviewed after he got the Nobel Prize. And he became a name to reckon with, and he became an icon, a literary, cultural icon of the Arabian world. And these statements will in fact explain to us as to what exactly this person meant through his writing. Now I take the first example. There is a quote: "History is full of people who went to prison or were burnt at the stake. Large number of people all over the world have been punished by history for proclaiming their ideas, because their ideas were so very different from that society, the society took action against them and killed them and burned them." I think he has the example of Joan of Arc in mind in France, who in the medieval period was killed because she was talking about the freedom of the country. So a person who talks about the freedom of the country is killed. And that's what he says. He says that history is full of people who went to prison or were burned at the stake for proclaiming their ideas. And then he says, society has always defended itself. Society never defends the individual, because the individual goes forward. Society wants to remain where it is, and there's a clash between the two. So whenever the individual takes a stand against society, critical of it, then the society punishes that individual, and society always defends itself. See the kind of wisdom that this person is able to project through his speech and through his writing. The other quote is, he says, "I believe society has a right to defend itself." Very nice. Even if society is wrong, it has a right to defend itself. This is called liberalism. You can't impose yourself on the society. Society wants to defend itself, just as the individual has the right to attack that with which he disagrees. So this kind of opposition should always remain between the two. The individual would like to criticize society, let him criticize. The society would like to defend itself, let it defend. So that there is a clash, and there is no imposition either from society's side or from the individual side. This is the kind of value he has, and this value, I think, the whole world, the entire world literature, all the poets and writers, they should cherish these values. So do not try to impose your views on the society in which you live. At the same time, if you find something objectionable in society, you must express it and stake your life for this. The third quote I say is once again to take him very close to the reality of the ground. For instance, what he says is, events at home, at work, in the street, these are the three places that all individuals know of. The people live in the home, they go to the work, and when they are away from home and when they are coming back, then they are on the street. These are three areas. So he says, events at home, at work, in the street, these are the bases for the story. He will write his stories on the basis of these three aspects of life: what is happening in your home, what is happening at your workplace, and what is happening on the way, on the street. So he will not go into the narratives of the palaces, narratives of the army, narratives of, you know, people who live in other parts of the world. He will not go into them. He'll write about his time. He'll write about his country. He'll write about his home, his place of work, and his street. Very nice. This is what literature should be. So these days, you know, many writers in the world, and we have discussed them, and we will discuss them in the series later, they do research. They go into different areas, and then they tell you what you do not know. That is one kind of writing. So which means that, there is a kind of research going on behind the writing of fiction. This person says, write about the home, write about what you see. That is important. So once again, you can think of the appeal of this writer. This writer will publish in thousands and lakhs, and he will be read by a large number of people, because he writes about their life. He writes about the home. Home is common to all of us. Then there is a quotation: as the tension eases, if it eases, tension is not, how has the tension eased in our country? How has tension eased in Egypt from 1952 onwards? How has tension eased in England from the Second World War onwards? Tension does not ease. But then he says, as the tension eases, we must look in the direction of agriculture. It's an important aspect. In the fields, what is happening? How things are produced? How crops are raised? Give attention to that. Industry, the second. Education, the third. And he says, these three are the final goals and toward democracy under Mr. Mubarak. He is very happy with Mr. Mubarak, the third president of who will serve the country for a good number of 10 years. So he says, and he is writing in his time, and he says, democracy under this person, always support it. Because this democracy will give you the freedom to talk. So these are the quotes, and the one last quote from his ideas: you can tell whether a man is clever by his answers. How to find out whether a man is intelligent? Well, you ask a question and the person answers, and the answer is very good. So what has happened? The person has been proved to be clever. But is the person wise? You can tell whether a man is wise by his questions, not his answers. The kind of question that the person asks, that tells us whether the man is wise or not. So asking questions is very important. So don't ask silly questions. Don't ask questions, which don't mean much, which takes in the wrong direction. So judge a person by his questions, not by his answers. This is, I think, very profound. And in fact, when he says questions, what he means is concerns, his interests, because the questions actually are the externalization, are the indicators of your interest. So if your interest is wrong, then your question will be wrong, and if your question is wrong, then the answer also is bound to be wrong. Then I give towards the end of the lecture a quote from, just a slice from, a spoonful from his fiction that he writes. He's making two characters talk. One is a doctor, the other is an old patient, and they talk with each other. And how they talk? The doctor says, he looks at the patient. He's not the patient now. He just came to meet him after many years. So he looks at this man and says, what a giant you are. You were always very tall, but now that you have put on weight, you have become enormous. He said, raising his head to Omar. The doctor generally doesn't talk like this, but this doctor is well-meaning. So in a way, he's telling him through a joke. He recognizes him and tells him that he has put on weight and he should shed it, the sooner the better. And Omar smiled with pleasure and repeated, I really did not think you'd remember me. He's very happy that his doctor has remembered him, even though he's criticizing him. But then doctor says, but I don't forget anyone. So how could I forget you? Once again, a kind of a joke. I don't forget anyone. That's a great doctor. A doctor has examined you. A doctor has seen your disease. A doctor was instrumental in curing you of the disease, gave you medicine, understood your nature, understood what suited you, what did not suit you. So the doctor was engaging seriously with you for 6 months or for a year. How can a doctor forget one's patient? This is what he says. And then see the writer's own comment on the dialogue. It was a gracious welcome from one in his position, doctor's position. After all, a distinguished physician is widely renowned. A good physician, everybody knows. Doctors, you know, nobody advertises that I'm a doctor and please come to me. Most of the advertisement happens through word of mouth. You meet your friend and your friend says, oh, you have this disease. Let me take you to my doctor. He's very good. So that's how doctors become renowned. So this is the wisdom of the author. He says, after all, a distinguished physician is widely renowned. And then he has a dig at somebody. He says, who hears of the lawyer other than those with legal cases? So nobody, no lawyer is that very, very famous. Only when, some legal case is fought, then the lawyer is referred to. But in the case of health, everybody thinks of a doctor. So if we have to choose a profession, say this man, then choose the profession of a doctor, because that will give you a concern for the health of others, will get a friend for you, a person who will always respect you. Anyway, this is just part of the novel and doesn't mean very seriously about this. But then the point I'm making is that he's writing about the relationship on the street in a doctor's shop between the patient and a doctor, and they're enjoying themselves and one is criticizing. And then, you know, that criticism makes us aware about the hidden questions of the society of the time. So with these points, you know, Nagi Mahfouz, a writer of fiction, a Nobel Prize winner, writing in Arabic and available to us in English translation. And when we read him, then we become clear about our own conditions in India. He writes about Egypt, and we understand through the Egypt example the conditions in India, which means that he is a transnational writer and he is fully eligible, I believe, to become a respectable author and citizen of world literature that we are discussing. So with this, I come to an end, and I hope you have enjoyed the lecture. You have at least understood the lecture, and go over and sift your own interests to examine where they stand in opposition to or in agreement with this author. Thank you.
With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so much for giving us this productive session. Friends, we believe that you might have gained lots and lots of information and knowledge through this session. If you have any query or if you wish to give your feedback for this particular lecture, then do write to us at info.cec@nic.in. We are taking your leave with the promise that we are going to meet again soon and would be continuing further in our series on 20th century world literature. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you once again.
Thank you.